I was telephoned by a friend one day who said he knew where there was a 1930 4.5-litre Bentley. And I knew that all 1930 specification cars had supercharged specifications for them. They had been intended for supercharging, but they never were. They were sold as unsupercharged cars. But I wanted this car because the supercharged car had a very heavy crankshaft and strong rods and valve gear and was ideal for racing. I bought the car, stripped it off its huge two-ton body and built a lightweight racing body for it. And in later years, I converted it again into a short chassis supercharged car. It was much great fun, good touring car, good racing car. But I was getting a bit bored with the weight of the supercharged Bentleys. It was an enormous weight, and one could sense this weight in accelerating, because when you open the throttle, it made more noise, but the increasing speed was not proportional to the increase in noise. And that was an indication of its great weight that it was pulling along. Also, it made life very difficult if you wanted to stop in a hurry, because of so much weight. It wasn't easy to get the brakes to hold back the car. I drove that car for a year or two and raced it. And then, to my astonishment, one day a telephone rang, and I was offered to buy the 1930 Birkin supercharged Le Mans team car. I mean, this was a very, very rare thing, and a very famous car. And, of course, I bought it. It cost a record price. I mean, everything I owned wasn't enough to pay for it, so I had to, again, search around for a bit of loose cash to do it, to sell a few watches and enough to cover my needs. And I got the car, and I enjoyed it very much. It was a very famous car, and it's quite fun to turn up at a meeting with the world's most famous supercharged Bentley. I drove it for about 12 years, and then I got tired of it, size and weight. And in spite of all its history, I decided it would have to go. But I added to its history while I had it at the Nürburgring in Germany, when a race was introduced for Bentleys and Mercedes. And it was retrospection of Birkin's appearance at the Nürburgring in 1926. When he was well and soundly beaten by the Mercedes, and so they thought they'd honour this event. Of course, the idea was that they nailed us once again, you see. And but I took my supercharged Bentley, and it had been Birkin's. And Birkin was the greatest driver in Europe, excepting only, I can't remember his name now, Nuvolari. He was the greatest driver in Europe, excepting Nuvolari. And I knew that Birkin, who had been dead for some 20 years, was not without capability of observing his car again. And I knew he was there watching me. And I didn't think I must win, but I knew I must put up a good show. So we set off, and it was a race to see who could do the fastest lap and who could produce the most regular lap times. And I figured that the easiest way to get the most regular lap times was to go flat out all the way. And if I went flat out all the way, maybe I might get the fastest lap. So off we went. And the race was terrific fun. And I wasn't sure which lap I was on. I wasn't sure what I was doing. I only sat there with my foot glued to the floor to keep the car at maximum speed. And at the end of the allotted time, it transpired that I'd won. And so it was a great victory for the car, you see. And the Germans didn't like it a bit. And they very reluctantly handed me over the silver cup, which was the cup that had been given in Birkin's day to the Mercedes team, but now to the English team. So that was my contribution to England's reputation. as a racing nation.